I've been over there since late 80s. Without the country.
Can you take any more?
Sullivan, I appreciate everybody coming out this evening. We've got a jam-packed meeting that we put together for you. And the first thing we always do is ask for an invocation. I wonder if Mr. Mike Scupin, our founder, might come up and give us an invocation.
If y'all don't mind, let's stand and pray, and then we'll do the pledge of allegiance. Father, we come to you just to thank you so much for the great God you are. We praise you. We worship you. We need you in our lives. More than that, we need you right now in our nation. Our nation is in trouble. We've moved so far away from the founding principles that you established, and we need to get back to those, and we just need your help to do it. We just pray that you'll continue to raise up people that will stand for your principles and will help take this nation back to what the Constitution originally meant. We pray tonight that you'll be with us in our meeting. We just pray that what we say here and do here will be pleasing to you. And we just thank you for this opportunity. For Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right.
Before we do this, everybody knows the pledge of this flag. I'm going to tell you the pledge of this flag. In case you stop. I pledge allegiance to the Georgia flag and to the principles for which it stands, wisdom, justice, and moderation. That's it. I remember that from first grade. So, let's do it. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right. I pledge allegiance to the Georgia flag and to the principles for which it stands, wisdom, justice, and moderation. Okay, thank you very much. We're living in some crazy times, folks. Anybody knows that? No. This isn't your mom and dad's America, is it? I don't think my dearly departed parents would recognize what's going on in this country. But we have a real chance at reversing all of that on November the 8th. And so I wanted to just have a meeting tonight that's going to do two things. We're going to talk about a Georgia issue tonight. We're going to talk about a federal issue tonight. The most important thing I can think of in our Georgia issues, which is also a federal issue, which, and Mr. Trump may be helping us solve our Georgia issues with education, is education itself. Because if we don't educate our young people with the truth, then what good is it? Our kids have got to understand the truth, and they've got to understand how to apply the truth in their lives. We're going to talk about truth throughout this evening as well, because it's vitally important. So the first folks I'm going to ask to come up here are Karen Solhiem and Sally Swift. Karen has been the president. This is Karen. President of the Georgia Association of Educators, retired organization. Is that so?
I'm over the hill.
You're okay. Over the hill. All right. And prior to that, she spent 29 years in public education teaching English and drama students in 8th grades 7 through 12. And she worked in the Jefferson City Schools for 20 years, and the Oconee County Schools for 9 years, and I had to abbreviate all the rest of it. But she is eminently qualified to be talking on the subject matter she's talking on tonight. Now, Sally Swift has been involved in public education for 30 years in various capacities. She was employed by the Daugherty County School System for 12 years and chose to work on more difficult schools. Sally has been employed by the Georgia Association of Educators for the past 18 years, and her duties with GAE have given her the opportunity to work in 40 different school systems. So these ladies are eminently qualified to be talking on the subject of education. Mike.
I would like to suggest that everyone use the microphone so that the recordings can pick up the sound better.
All right. Very good.
Can everyone hear? Is it too loud? You good? Okay.
Hey, Hank.
Yeah.
Also, we've got plenty of opposition signs back here, so you're just aware. Right here, I brought boxes of signs in.
What kind of signs?
Opposition signs to Amendment 1 right there.
All right. Very good. All right.
Karen.
Karen. I was going to say, Sal, I'm going to turn it over to Karen, right?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right, there you go.
Thank you so much, and thanks for coming out this evening. And I need you to give me a finger, and the appropriate one when I ask, please, is if you really feel confident talking about Amendment 1, if you kind of have heard of it sideways, and if you're like, Amendment 1, we're having an election, a thumbs down. So this would be the time you give me a finger this way, or this way. Okay, I just kind of wanted to see who the audience was in the room, and thank you for that. And if you need my contact information after all this is over and done and you want to talk to me, I'll be happy to give that to you one-on-one. And as Hank said, I'm a former English teacher, so today we're going to keep it simple, and we're only going to count to four because I can do that. And we're going to talk about four things concerning what's going on for November 8th and Amendment 1. And the first one is audience participation with one ballot amendment. And on the ballot, and for some of you in the back, you may have to squint at this point in time, will there be Amendment 1 the way it is, or are we interested in Amendment 4 the way it's written? So this is audience participation. Somebody shout out an answer.
No.
That is not, it's either A or B, Stephen.
I didn't have my glasses on, excuse me.
Well, B is what it really is.
Exactly. So if you haven't early voted yet, with early voting starting this past Monday, when you go to the polls, the amendment that I'm concerned about as being a previous public school educator is Amendment 1. There will be four amendments in all. And the language for the one below isn't what's going to appear on the ballot. So if you're going through and you're talking to people about the Opportunity School District, that really isn't going to appear on the ballot. What you are going to see on the ballot is the 24 words, as I refer to them, that we've known about for over a year, about amending the Georgia Constitution. And it says, to allow the state to intervene in chronically failing public schools in order to improve student performance. And people will see, improve student performance, yeehaw, that's what we want to do. And they'll go through and they perhaps will vote not the way my organization would like them to. And then to go through and sweeten it, we finally did find out a couple months ago what amendment number it was. So it's good to be able to tell people to vote no on one. But then they added about, 6 weeks ago, the preamble. And doesn't this sound like the best thing since sliced bread? Amendment 1 provides greater flexibility and state accountability to fix failing schools through increasing community involvement. And I'm not quite sure how that is supposed to happen through this amendment, but we have, GAE has filed a lawsuit against the language of Amendment 1. We probably will not have an outcome before the election, but it does go through and raise and hold up the fact that perhaps the wording of Amendment 1, and maybe other amendments, but I'm just talking about Amendment 1, isn't as clear as it could be.
Well, I said the legislation did not. The legislators did not vote on that preamble or the wording, and that's one of the main reasons for the lawsuit.
Who
did it?
Who wrote it?
Yeah, that's
who you go after.
Do you want
staffers right there? Yes.
Start naming names.
And I will at the end. So when you go to the ballot, you only have the yes or no choice on Amendment 1 with the preamble and with the 24 words. You don't get to check maybe or anything else that you might want to write in. You have to check yes or no, and you can't say, oh, I'll think about this later. Not appearing on the ballot, but part of the long sheet that each of you were handed on one side, you'll see what Senator Vincent Fort put out trying to get the language of the 24 words substituted. It did not pass, but this is a pretty accurate assessment of what Amendment 1 really should say. amending the Constitution to allow an appointee of the governor to bypass the elected state school superintendent in order to take over local school operations, buildings, and control of all federal, state, and local funding if a school has low scores on standardized tests or for any other reason a future legislative act may allow. And I'm pausing on those last five words, future legislative act may allow. I'll talk about that in just a minute. Also, as I mentioned, not appearing on the November 8th ballot is anything about the words Opportunity School District. And if you're in education, you always like to abbreviate things, so we talk about the OSD. You will not find that at all on the ballot. We're up to 2 of 4. Two pieces of legislation. The first came about, both of these did, at the 2015 General Assembly. And the Senate resolution provides what the people will see on the ballot in terms of the 24 words. So again, we've known about the 24 words for a while. And then it provides the actual language, should this pass, that will be inserted into the Georgia Constitution. Because if you remember, it starts out, shall the Constitution of Georgia be amended? So two paragraphs will be inserted if this passes, and this is the wording for those. And this is where we get the term Opportunity School District, because that's the title of the two paragraphs. And if you read really quickly what's in red, you'll see that the first paragraph deals with the schools themselves. And the second paragraph deals with the money aspect of it. And nowhere in the insertion into the Georgia Constitution is there anything about what we're going to do to help students or teachers or academics. As my representative, I live over in Athens, Clark, says, this is a facilities management piece of legislation. It deals with the buildings and the revenue connected with those buildings. Second piece of legislation I carry around with me if you want to see it, it's the Senate Bill 133, and it's the enabling legislation. It's about 13 pages. So this is what is the workings should this amendment pass. And I go through and I say the workings for now, because these 13 pages of the Senate bill, it's a resolution, and we kind of know how we're going to operate, at least for now, if this amendment passes. But remember the part of any future legislative act? If these two paragraphs are inserted into the Constitution, then any future legislature can come along and change the recipe for the state takeover. So right now, I kind of liken this, because I like to eat, that we have a recipe for chocolate chip cookies. We know the ingredients, the bake time, the mix time, the prep time, blah, blah, blah. But a future legislature can come along and say, oh, we don't like chocolate chip, let's make oatmeal raisin, and go through and change the ingredients, change the cook time, etc. Three models that this particular OSD, Opportunity School District, is based on. And if you want to do your homework and gather facts for yourself, you're more than welcome. We have the Recovery School District in Louisiana, came about after Hurricane Katrina. And then we have the Michigan Education Achievement Authority, and lastly, the Tennessee Achievement School District. And just a paragraph or so that you probably can't read from the back, and I apologize for that. But Diane Ravitch, who's a public education proponent, she goes through earlier this year and she takes these three school districts, these state takeover districts, to task. And for the Recovery School District at the very end, she had said, some critics have called it the lowest performing district in one of the lowest performing states. And then for Michigan, she says it has no defenders. It's a disaster. And lastly, with the Tennessee Achievement District, she cites research and it says the lowest performing schools are still very low performing schools. So we have models we've used that haven't been successful. So I'm not sure the model that we're putting forth will be. Three things to know, we're only going to four. So the what, the who, and the when. The what. We've been talking about failing schools. So we need to know what the criteria are for failing schools. Anybody know besides Stephen, who's an educator, and his lovely wife back there? Anybody else know what the criteria is?
Passing the test?
It does have to do with passing the test. And it's actually a little bigger picture than that. If a school is deemed as failing, it has an F rating, and that is currently by the recipe defined as being a 60 or below, again, an arbitrary number that is in the recipe at this point, on something called the CCRPI, which is abbreviation you can see for the College and Career Ready Performance Index, which is a measure that was never designed to give a school a score. It was designed to see whether a student is ready for the work of the career work or college work. And in education over the last 3 years, even what's emphasized in the CCRPI is weighted differently from year to year. So across 3 years, we're not comparing apples to apples. We kind of have a fruit salad going on. And inherent also in the CCRPI, which is based on largely on test scores, it's also a school can have a low score if it has a high absentee rate. And I'm not quite sure how a school can go through and make students physically attend school, but I'm not in charge. And then a low graduation rate. I mean, somebody may have to drop out for a reason. And then having the low scores on standardized tests, and my diatribe on standardized tests can be left for another day. But suffice it to say, the Georgia Milestones test, which is the standardized test and company used in Georgia, the scores for the last couple years have been thrown out for students and not counted because of testing irregularities. But yet these milestone scores count for teachers in the teacher's evaluation and go and are rolled into the CCRPI scores for schools. So again, just seems like it should count for everybody or not count for everybody. If the amendment passes, according to the recipe so far, there could be in the Opportunity School District up to 100 failing schools. And a school would stay in for a minimum of 5 years, maximum of 10 years, unless it's successful for 3 years in a row and then it can come out. And up to 20 failing schools can be put in the OSD per year. And you can Google online and you can see the list of the failing schools. The test results came out in May of this year. And based on CCRPI scores, 60 or below, three consecutive years, we have 127 failing schools in Georgia, which represent 22 school systems. And you can see by the map, hopefully, that there are a lot in the metro Atlanta area, and then we have some dispersed in other areas of the state. And are there any in Hall County? No, okay, there aren't any in Hall County. And a lot of times when I do these presentations, people will say, well, why should we be concerned? It's not in our county. Well, realize the recipe has the 60 or below in there as an ingredient for now. A future legislature can come through and say, oh, let's make it 75 or below. Or let's make it 5% on a growth model, and if a school's at a 96%, it's never going to get the full 5%. Stephen?
There are actually quite a number of schools, though, that are at risk for this. They're borderline.
Are they focused
missing
schools?
I beg your pardon?
Are they focused schools? They're next on the list.
Well, they're missing it by 1 year scores.
So people who are going through and saying, oh, we don't have to worry, maybe not in today's recipe, but we may be changing the ingredients. And the schools, the 127 schools, represent 6% of the schools in Georgia. So we'd be working towards, according to this amendment, changing the Constitution for 6% of the schools and less than 4% of the students in Georgia. So it's not as if we have a wholesale problem. And yes, we do have some struggling schools. And based on the CCRPI and the failing schools from the previous year, you can see that it's high minority students of the 139 failing schools from the previous year, and 92% of them are on free and reduced lunch. And the who on this is the governor, and whoever that might be, currently Governor Deal. And what he's going to do, according to the recipe, is to appoint an opportunity school district superintendent to run the OSD. And the superintendent would be selected by the governor. He has to be approved by the Georgia Senate, but he doesn't have to have any additional criteria other than what any local school superintendent has to have, which is breathing and high school degree. So it doesn't have to go through and be somebody who's melded into education or has a business background. It can be whoever the governor decides. And that person's going to be housed in the governor's office of student achievement. Now, those of us, in education, remember that there's also a Georgia Department of Education. And we go through and we elected Richard Woods in the last go-around to be the state school superintendent. And if we don't like what Richard Woods does, then we unelect him and find somebody else to run in the next go-around. So we're in essence having a dual education bureaucracy set up through passing this amendment, one with an elected superintendent in the DOE, and then one with an appointed superintendent in the governor's office of student achievement. And it's not like, Sally mentioned just a minute ago, focused schools. It's not like the DOE isn't going through and addressing struggling schools. It has two programs, focused schools, priority schools, which are addressing Title I schools and students who might need some extra help. So it's not like we're ignoring where there needs to be funds put and extra energy put within the state. When? If this passes, it goes into effect January 1, 2017. The recipe says that the appointed superintendent by April 1st has to let the schools he's chosen know that they'll go into the OSD. The schools, it'll take place starting the next school year. And we're up to number four, four intervention models. What happens to a school that's selected for the opportunity school district is based solely on the appointed superintendent. He gets to decide. And there are four intervention models in all. He can decide that the school will be part of a statewide school district. So he'll have schools from all over the state in one school district, and DeKalb County has about 125 schools within that one county, and that's large. I'm not quite sure how we'll deal with after-school competitions, just with the students going and competing against each other. And right now, if I don't like what's happening in my school system, I can go about 10 miles down the road and talk to my superintendent in my county. People will have to go to Atlanta to talk to the OSD superintendent. Second model, shared governance. Again, the OSD superintendent gets to decide if this is an option. And what this means, he just says, oh, we're going to play nicely with the local education authority. Except I, as OSD superintendent, get to appoint the principal for that school. And every failing school in the OSD will have a governing board, and the OSD superintendent gets to decide who's on that governing board. The third one, the school could, according to the OSD superintendent, become a charter school. And if it's capped for this option. Once it becomes a charter school, it can never revert back to anything else. And this allows for-profit and non-profit entities to come in our state. And according to the State Charter Commission, not only could bus drivers be privatized, cafeteria workers, parapros, but the teaching staff that's credentialed could be fired. And then people, according to the State Charter Commission, again, who are breathing and have a high school degree, could be elected to be the teachers at a charter school. And the last one, the OSD superintendent could decide to close down the school. Students are bused throughout the district, never mind it might take them more hours on the school bus to get to and from school. Staff is dispersed throughout the district if there's room. And if there needs to be a reduction in force, the school district, the local school district, gets to deal with that. And if a facility is closed, it cannot reopen as the same kind of grade level facility for 3 years. So in Athens Clark, we have Gaines Elementary on the list. If the OSD superintendent taps that school to go into the OSD, it's closed down. It cannot open as an elementary school for 3 years. It could open as a middle school, a high school, but I'm not sure the football players could quite fit in the little desks. And again, this is at the discretion of the appointed superintendent. He has to hold at least one public hearing to get community input. I guess that's involving the community. But if you don't like the decision, well, that's really too bad, because according to the recipe, there is no appeals process for this. He is the sole decider. And follow the money. This is a revenue neutral piece of legislation. It means there's no new funding put in. And this is a quote from the website on the Governor's Opportunity School District. The schools within the OSD are entitled to all local, state, and federal funds that were available to the school prior to the transfer of the school into the OSD. Which means if Gaines Elementary closes in my community, my local tax dollars for that school are now part of the operating budget for the OSD, less up to 3% that can be kept out, according to the current recipe, for administrative costs by the OSD. So it's not necessarily getting even the full funding. And again, my local tax dollars for education will be sent to the state for the operation of it. And then, the General Assembly may appropriate additional funds to be allocated among the schools within the OSD at the discretion of the OSD superintendent for necessary and innovative purposes. So if there's not enough money, and there hasn't been enough money in public education since the inception of the current funding formula in 1985, QBE, Quality Basic Education, it's not ever been fully funded. Educators have gone through austerity cuts, furlough days, etc. But in order to, you know, make sure the OSD has enough money, this is an option. And my rationale is there's only one pot of money in Georgia that can be allocated, and education's a pretty good portion of that. But if some is taken off for operation of the Opportunity School District, it means less funding for education in the local districts throughout the state. And it does allow for philanthropic funding. People with deep pockets can come in and contribute. And again, contract with nonprofit and for-profit providers. So it does say private funds may be solicited to support these schools. The facilities. If my lovely Gaines Elementary is taken over by the OSD, everything that's within the building, the computer, the chairs, the tables, the books, the flower pots, whatever, now belong to the Opportunity School District. Except if the roof leaks or the air conditioner stops, then the local district is responsible for major capital repairs. So you will not see this language on the ballot. But I hope through going through this, it makes a little more sense why Vincent Ford wanted to change and have this language, because again, I think it's a fairly accurate translation of what Amendment 1 is. Instead, you'll get Amendment 1, the preamble, and the 24 words. So thank you so much for listening, sir.
I've got a question for you. Now, the state of Georgia would never go into something like this with the idea that the new program is going to fail. No, it's going to be wildly successful. And so let's just assume that the program is wildly successful and that all of the schools that are put into this program all of a sudden start producing students with incredible scores. And then, that being the case, they no longer are failing schools. So then they would then rightly, justifiably, be given back to the regular school system, because this is for failing schools. So if that actually happened, it seems like to me that the new school superintendent and all of the staff that are underneath him are working themselves out of a job by performing and creating a program that actually works, isn't that?
I think there was a question in there.
Am I saying this right?
You are. And the lens I look through, too, is if there were a panacea for public education that's working for everybody in Georgia or across the nation, by gosh, by golly, let's get on the bandwagon and let's do this. But whoever comes in on Monday morning, it's still going to be those same students that need educating. So,
I want to give y'all a little history about this. There's a group called Students First that is for privatizing public schools. They are the ones that paid for the legislators in the governor's office to go see the New Orleans model several years ago. And they wined and dined them and all that. But the scores show that it's not working. And last May, they gave the schools back. The Michigan model that she talked about, the governor came out in June. This legislation, he has wrote legislation for it to go back into the public schools because it hasn't worked in Michigan. There are several lawsuits in Tennessee where the money has been mismanaged and has now disappeared, and there's no money to educate the children.
You're kidding me.
No, you can Google it. It's all over the place. So those are a few things that, you know, it hasn't worked anywhere else. They're having major problems in Florida with some that they've privatized like this. So, I mean, I ask that people do their research. If you get out there and do your research, you can see that this hasn't worked. Why do we want to bring it into Georgia if it hadn't worked? And another thing I wanted to let you know, the funding that we're talking about, if they go for a private charter, Michelle Reeves' husband owns one of the largest for-profit chains. If you trace back the money to all the legislators that helped write the bill, along with the governor, they all got donations in their campaign from these for-profit charter companies, and Governor Deal got over $4 million. Freddie Paul Sims, which was one of the deciding votes to make this happen, who co-sponsored the bill, got a new arts theater at Albany State College that they've denied for the last 15 years, but all of a sudden she's got a several-million-dollar building. So if you ever trace the money, it tells you a whole lot. Yes, sir.
It's my understanding Senator Butch Miller was one of the proponents of this. Did he get anything special that you're aware of?
We looked at all the ones that co-sponsored the bill, and every one of them got different amounts for their campaign re-election last year. So you can actually go, it's all public information, and it will tell you how much and who donated to their, but every one of them got money from the for-profit charter companies. I remember Governor Deal's because it was $4 million.
Gary.
Yes, sir.
There's something more sinister going on in this that's not being talked about because it's ugly. I already voted against this the first day of voting. If you looked at the map of where the schools were concentrated, Atlanta, around the Cab area. I live in the Cab and I work in Fulton County area. There is massive gentrification taking place. Gentrification is basically where the face of a neighborhood changes over time. Properties are bought up, rehabbed. The people that generally live in the neighborhood can no longer afford to live in that neighborhood, and they are forced outward. Those schools that the governor wants control of the money and the building and the resources for is to facilitate shutting down those schools that mostly poor blacks and poor whites attend. And once they are gone, they will be repurposed because the governor will be controlling. And one thing we always forget, the experiment is always done, unfortunately, on the Negro first, and why this will be so advantageous for the governor. You already got kids that don't want to be in school in these failing schools. And you got parents that give little to no participation whatsoever. And when people read the language as it is on the ballot, white people are going to say, oh, so they want to make schools better. And black folks are going to say, oh, so now they're going to come in and do something about these bad schools. But that's not what happened, and she just laid it out for you. And my fear is that it will pass, and you will see the end of the school system for black folks. And guess what? Once they succeed with the black folks, white folks will be next.
I would like to introduce Briana Bivens. She is this region's coalition for the state campaign on keeping Georgia schools local. We have yard signs we brought. I have extra information and materials, but it's going to take all of us together working to stop this. If I go tell 10, Briana goes tell 10, Karen goes tell 10, and their 10 goes tell 10, we have to actually have 2,140,000 votes to stop this because it's a presidential election. So I need your help. We all do, so we can help the children. And people say, well, what's the plan to help? They're not. As we showed you, the Department of Education, Richard Wood's office, has a priority school plan that is working and improving, and so is the focus schools. From year before last, those have definitely improved. It's a slow process.
If I can just say one thing really quickly. Thank you. Again, my name is Brianna Bivens. I'm the regional field coordinator in North Georgia to defeat Amendment 1. I'll just reiterate that this amounts to nothing more than a political power grab and a transfer of dollars and resources from local communities to a single political appointee, which to me is really terrifying. And I think none of us is sitting around sort of saying that we don't have schools that are underperforming, but I think the solutions have to come from the ground up, from the people that are in the communities day in and day out. Additionally, if you feel really passionately about this and are interested in getting involved, we definitely need help to spread the word, making phone calls, knocking on doors, talking to friends, things like that. So there is a little sign-up sheet in the back, and if you wouldn't mind signing up, that would be a great help. We're nearing the election, and people are already voting, so we've got a lot of work to do. Thank you all.
So thank you so much for your time and attention, and go forth and spread the word. Thank you.
Thank you all very much. I'm always amazed and gratified by citizens such as we have right here who will leave their homes and travel out in the middle of the night and come out here and speak to a group of people about something they feel this strongly about. And it's a vital issue, and I think you shared some great information that we did not know about. Thank you very much for coming out and doing that for us. They really deserve a hand, as is so many people. In fact, everybody here deserves a hand. Give yourselves a hand. Please, you left your homes too. It's not like the speakers are the only people that leave home. You guys come in. Michael.
Before we leave the amendment issue, I would just like to make a very brief statement, and I'll be glad to go into detail with anyone that wants to hear it. None of these amendments should pass. They are all bad for the state of Georgia for different reasons. One thing that you should learn from the wording that you just saw in this amendment is they lie to us when they put these amendments to amend our Constitution on the ballot. They do it every single time. What it says is never what it does. And that's true with Amendment 2, Amendment 3, and Amendment 4. All of them have background information that if you knew it, you would never touch any of them.
Yes, sir. Yeah, since we're lucky enough to have a state senator here who voted to authorize this, could we get the other perspective on it?
He's going to speak to us tonight.
Wonderful.
So
you
can talk to us about that.
Now, I had originally thought that this would be a good idea to get together a group of people that are concerned about the direction of our country this close to the election and just kind of talk about it a little bit. And I'm hoping to kind of raise some spirits a little bit because we're in a real precarious place. But you know what? I'm optimistic that we're going to be doing some really good things in our country. And I have a lot of good reasons to think that way, and one of them is just a faith in God. You know, there we got a decision to be making here on November the 11th and November the 8th concerning the direction of our country. Either it's gonna turn around and start going the right direction, or that's it. I've done enough studying in this to understand that this country is heading in a trajectory that is at a point of no return if we make the wrong decision. And so tonight, I asked two of my favorite speakers to come out and speak to us on this subject of the presidential election. Both of them are Trump supporters. I am a Trump supporter. I came out last year in October about this time after I finally figured out that, okay, he's real. Nobody's going to say this many things to make so many people in the establishment that mad unless the guy's real. And that's when I jumped on the Trump train. But I'm going to bring Derrick up in just a second. This morning, Derrick posted something that I thought was very intriguing. And that was that he put a video up of Michael Moore. Everybody know who Michael Moore is? Anybody kind of think along the same lines politically as Michael Moore? Anybody? No. All right, one of the things that I've done here since throughout my tenure of working here with the great folks among us at Lanier Tea Party Patriots is stress the idea that the closer we all come to understanding the real truth of the matter, the more our opinions will converge. One of the reasons why we have so many people that are on this side or that side is because they understand different facts. But nobody really understands the entire truth. So, but if they did understand the truth, then their opinions would most likely converge on that particular subject. So this morning, I'm watching this video that Derrick posts, and it's Michael Moore, and he's standing outside the Ecuadorian embassy in London, where Julian Assange has been holed up for the last 4 years. Because if he comes out, he's going to be snatched.
5 years.
5 years. He's going to be snatched. So he's in prison behind the walls of this Ecuadorian embassy. But yet, now there are people who disagree that what he's done has been good. But in my way of thinking, and I probably can predict most of the people in this room, it's a great clearinghouse to understand what the real truth of the matter of what's been going on in our government really is. And so what was interesting to me is this theme that has pervaded all of my meetings here about understanding the truth was born out in this. Because here's Michael Moore, whom I don't agree with anything about him, but he's up there saying, he's pleading with Mr. Obama, let this man out. He's just telling us the truth. You know, leave, let the dogs go. You know, this guy is telling us the truth, and the truth needs to be known. And so here it is. We're talking about the truth, and we're talking about two people who understand the same truth, and we feel the same way about it. So obviously, there is something about truth that connects us all. And that is a biblical principle. You know, the Bible says that all truth comes from God. And so if you just speak the truth, then you're kind of like a prophet of God, are you not? You're saying truth. It came from God. Well, you're a prophet of God. So here it is. We have falsehood in this world and truth in this world. And our jobs here in this world is to try to figure out how to reconcile all the falsehood with the truth, and do so in a way that in an environment of limited resources. That's the kick. It wouldn't matter what was true and what was false unless we're all vying for the same resources. And then it really starts to matter. So that's what this is all about. And the reason why I bring this up before I bring Derrick up here is that Derrick has a nickname, and it is the Minister of Truth, TMOT. He goes by TMOT. He has a great YouTube channel. He puts up great messages, sometimes prolifically. And so if you are on YouTube, please go to Derrick's YouTube channel and start getting plugged into this. But Derrick is one of these people that are few and far between. There's a lot of them in this room, and so there's a lot of them that have come together here, who values the truth more than life itself, because it is the truth that ultimately will support our life after this life, if it's going to support it at all. So that's the important thing. And since I have known him, I have always enjoyed every time he's come to speak to us, and every time I've heard him speak, because the guy speaks the truth. And with that in mind, I would like to introduce you to TMOT, the Minister of Truth, Derrick Grayson. You thought you gave me a good introduction.
Well, good evening, everyone. I want to make this known that initially, I was not a Trump supporter. I voted for Rand Paul in the primary. And Hank began to reach out to me, and he said, Derrick, I need you to really dig deep, because I know you will dig deep. And I started digging deep. Every aspect of Trump, I researched. I looked at everything that I could. Just like I've done with everyone, Bush, Obama, Hillary, Rand Paul, Ron Paul. I research because I like to vote with knowledge. There aren't many people like that, and that's the sad part. Most people vote for the D or for the R. However, if you are fortunate enough to be able to articulate your argument, you may be able to convince some people to do something different. This is why I went from 1% of the vote in 2014 to 12% of the vote in 2016, and I'm not done yet. I'm still talking to people. Now, there is one group of people, that group that God talks about, hardened hearts, no eyes to see, no ears. There's nothing you're going to do for them. But if you can get their attention for just a moment, and you are able to articulate adequately your positions, they will listen to you, and they will give pause, thought, and they may change their mind. I have changed a number of black folks' minds about Donald Trump by simply explaining who Hillary is, and when they got upset and countered with what Trump is, what they've heard, I say, hold on, just calm down. Do you want the answer? Because I'll give you the answer that you can verify, but you have to listen to me. So you have to be prepared to do that. Now I want to share something that I had reservations about sharing. Because I'm a deep thinker. I look at the bigger picture, just like with the education deal. I know that's, they're just backdooring Common Core and picking a group that's going to care the less and not realize the importance or the significance of what they're getting ready to do. And I can say that because I've seen it, I live it, I see it in the neighborhoods that I have grown up in. I have seen the destruction of black communities. So what I'm about to say to you, and I'm streaming it over the internet so that everybody will hear it. Last night, when I got home, before I went in to watch the debate, I was troubled, I mean troubled, deep in my soul. Because of some people that I had talked with earlier that had given me a real hard time. Generally, I just let it roll off of my back like water. But this really troubled me, and I sat in my car, and I asked God, literally, Lord, what is the one thing that I can do that would make people stop and at least pay attention? Because you aren't going to get it from the representatives, the senators, or Hillary. The three people that have done more to expose the corrupt, the diabolical policies of our government are the ones who are most attacked, even by the people they were trying to help. They are Edward Snowden. He told you what your government was doing to you that they had no business doing. Julian Assange, who says that our two-party system is corrupt to the hilt and needs to be brought down. And Donald Trump, who in the very first debate stood up and said, essentially, now I'm going to paraphrase, actually I'm going to tell you what he said, and I'm going to tell you what he really meant. He said, I buy politicians on both sides. I have to, because I have to get along with everybody. For my family, for my businesses, and for my employees. Now I look deep into that. Wait a minute. He just admitted it at first. I didn't see it for what it was. But I said, well, how can the pimp be mad with the whore? But most pimps pimp because they want to. Donald Trump was paying off people so that he could operate businesses for his family and for his employees, because they were taxing the hell out of him. Regulations were killing him. If you got 15 manufacturers or 15 businesses that sell ties in America, and they get all of them made over in China, and Trump is in the tie business, in order to stay competitive, Trump has to start buying his ties the same place just so he can compete with the other folks. So many of us have no clue what it takes to do business under our current form of government and its political corruption. So when I ask God, what is the one thing that I could do, God, that would make people stop and listen? Because I know I put the information out there. And I'm going to tell you, you know what thought crossed through my mind? Do a final drive time and explain to the people what's going on and how dire things are in this country. Because if Hillary Clinton wins, there will be World War III. There will be, she said last night, yeah, well, you know, with some negotiations, if Russia or Syria violates the no-fly zone, yeah, you know, we may be forced to shoot them down. That will be the start of your World War III. Because Russia is not backing down. And Trump articulated that. And I say, so God, in this last video, what if I give them and tell them how dire this is, and I take this gun and kill myself live sacrifice my life, lay down my life, just to get the attentions of Americans so that they will realize how serious this is. I have five daughters. And if Hillary Clinton gets in office, there won't be nothing left for them. Having me and no life is worthless to me. I want them to have a future, like how my father fought for my future when he fought against Jim Crow. This is where we are today, all being slaves. And I wrestled with that thought, and I said, foolish heart, God would never condone such an act. Get up, go on in here and watch this debate. And I was glad I watched that debate because Donald Trump walked a mud hole dry in Hillary Clinton. Now, I want to do something different, and Hank, you'll have to stop me when my time is up. The reason many of us cannot advocate for Trump or explain Hillary is because we don't have the information. We don't have the facts. Well, I support Trump because, we get lost. We can't articulate it. But if you can articulate it, you can explain it. If you understand it, you can see it and you can tell it to somebody else. That's why Jesus taught his disciples first before he sent them out. Because they needed an education. They needed to understand what this corruption is all about. So I'm going to go around the room and I want you to ask me any question about why it could be, well, why shouldn't I vote for Hillary about this particular thing, or Donald Trump is a racist, or give me anything that you may have been challenged with yourself, and I will show you how to address those issues. So let's start right here. You got a question for me?
Sure.
Okay. I'll repeat it. She wants to know, what do you say when people talk about the demeaning things that supposedly Trump is saying about women? First and foremost, Trump never says anything about women in the plural sense of the word. Has Trump attacked some individual women? He most certainly has. But like I tell everybody, if you do some research, you can find where Trump got hit first. And Trump's personality, an alpha male, when he hits back harder. And that's what you see. Him and Rosie O'Donnell, that wasn't the first issue that they had, but they seized upon the fact that Rosie O'Donnell is a woman, and now they want to make Trump out to be the misogynist, a man who hates women, which is not the truth. That is not true at all. So that's what I would say to folk when they bring that to me. Has Trump talked about particular women? Yes, he has. But he's also talked about men equally as bad. So Trump gives it to whoever gives it to him. You, sir. Ma'am. Come on now. I know y'all got some. Give me one, sir.
Come back to me.
Okay. Ma'am.
Is his general rudeness and crudeness?
Okay, what about it?
Well, it's offensive to a lot of people, especially here in the South.
Okay. Well, when you have built up an atmosphere.
Repeat the question.
Oh, she wanted to know that his crudeness and rudeness is offensive to a lot of people. I say two things to that. Trump is ruder to the person that was rude to him. He'll be crude to the person, cruder to the person that was cruel to him. And people have said some ugly things about Donald Trump. I remember when Donald Trump first got in the race, first thing that the media did was picture Donald Trump dressed up with the big red nose clown, the hair, the whole nine yards, and talked about leading up the clown car. But nobody said anything about that, but it's okay for them to do it to Trump, but it's not okay for Trump to attack back. And we are not used to that. And that's difficult for some people, but I say to you this, I'm more concerned about the future of America than Trump's rudeness, because I know Trump won't bend over for anybody. And I remember everybody that complained about Obama when he went, it was either Syria, Saudi Arabia, or Japan, where they criticized Obama for almost bowing to the emperor. So, you know, you want a man that's gonna stand up, Or do you want somebody who's not afraid to speak his mind? I'd rather know what you are thinking than what you are not. So that's what I say to people, ma'am, when they say that to me. Young lady.
Is Trump going to be able to be diplomatic when he needs to be?
Trump, like all presidents, is Trump going to be able to be diplomatic? This is the example that I give to people. Trump took $14 or $15 million. Now, $1 million is a very small percentage of a billion. $100 million or $1 billion is $100 million 10 times. Donald Trump took $15 million and turned it into at least $1 billion, which means Trump is very good at what he does when it comes to negotiating good deals. And it has made him very wealthy. And unlike all of the other people in politics, they go into politics to get self-enriched, like Hillary and Bill Clinton. Trump is a self-made man who did it from working hard. And Trump woke up and realized, I am being made a slave too, and I can't keep buying off politicians on both sides of the aisle. It's got to end, so let me expose it. So yes, I believe that Trump will be able to be diplomatic. Ma'am? Okay, I have empathy for human beings. I'm gonna give you an example. How is Trump going to deal with the amnesty issue? Is he being too heavy-handed? So the immigration issue is a big one for a lot of people because Trump is oftentimes misquoted. Last night he made clear, first, we are going to secure the border. Then we're going to get all of the bad people out, the people actively breaking laws, other than the first one coming here illegally. And then we'll decide later what to do with the rest. Now that's part of that part I was talking about, how Trump has evolved over time and has learned how to articulate and communicate his policies. He even said, because I've heard people say, well, Trump only talked about the Second Amendment. Last night, Trump plainly said, we need to preserve first and foremost the Second Amendment, but we need to preserve all of them. And so when people say, well, I didn't hear that, let me pull it up for you and show you on my iPhone. Always be able to give people or point them to the answers so that they can see for themselves. See, you teach a man, give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day. Teach a man to fish, he'll eat for a lifetime. Yes, ma'am. No question, sir.
Two things that he brought up the other night, which I'm very much for: term limits.
Okay.
Senators and reps. The rep would get two or three terms, period, and then the senators would only get two. Mm-hmm. This is where we need to hit. Do it very quickly. On everything else, I'm 100% behind him because I'm an Appenrail, and I see where he's coming from. You've got to understand the press controls so much of this. This is how these people are influenced. They don't like this, they don't like that. Well, where did they get that impression? It's the press.
Yes, yes it is. He asked about term limits. If I have heard people when I was on the campaign trail in 2014 and 2016 ask me what did I think about term limits, I used to always tell them I will only serve one term. Because if I'm no use to you in one term, why would you send me back for a second term? Mm-hmm. We fire football players after one, football coaches after two losing seasons in this country. We need to do the same thing with politicians. So if ever you wanted an opportunity to clean house, if for no other reason, Trump is your guy, because Trump said, I will push for a constitutional amendment. And then I heard people, Trump can't pass a constitutional amendment. Wait a minute, why are you confusing people? The man plainly said, I will push, meaning I'm going to encourage the people. There are 10 amendments in this country that was passed in a year because some honorable people put it before the people and told them why these are important and why we need them. So if the people understand what's being brought forth, and I think everybody in this country, most people in this country, with the exception of those 435 people up there in D.C., want term limits. I want term limits, you want term limits, he wants term limits. Trump said he'll push for it. So if Trump is pushing for term limits, all Trump has to do is tell the people, okay, people, I've told you legislatures, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. If they aren't moving forward, you need to fire them and get somebody else that's going to get this legislation passed. And that's what the man said he'll do, and I believe that he will.
Another thing, too, on this education thing, two things that he said would solve some of these problems. He said, he's against Common Core. I'm sure this has got a good dose of that in it.
Yeah.
And then secondly, he said he was for local control. Okay?
So, which is what we need. Absolutely right.
That will maintain, hopefully.
You got a question, sir?
Well, I had a hard time thinking, but actually it should have been easy. The one thing sometimes I wonder when he's in a debate with somebody is I'm thinking, elevate your game to focus on certain things that I think about. Is he doing this a little bit on purpose? Is he holding back, for example? Or is he a guy that sometimes on the spot that you think, it doesn't quite grasp that, but like me, sometimes after the conversation was like, well, this is exactly what I would have done. What do you think? You know what I'm saying?
Right. You're basically asking about Trump's etiquette.
Well, partially, but also because I think of what Trump's beliefs are. Had he been able to attack some of the details that Clinton, who is a professional liar and slander and that sort of stuff, immediately, I think he would have like wiped out the debates even more to a lot of people, is what I'm saying.
I'm not sure what your question is.
No, I guess he, in other words, he doesn't come up sometimes with that exactly mathematical answer that should have been, you know what I'm saying? In other words, dang, he should have told
me. We have had at least 100 years of polished politicians giving us the script. They even said last night that Hillary Clinton was basically regurgitating a playbook script on all of the answers that she gave. Trump spoke honestly and from the heart.
Yeah. Let me touch on that. You'll notice that when Trump is first asked a question, he may not articulate a point of view that is going to be his ultimate point of view. But Trump is one of these people. You watched The Apprentice. Did you ever watch The Apprentice? Well, what you saw there is a guy who's sitting there thinking, and he's listening to all the people in the room and everything that they've got to say. And then he goes to his advisors, and he listens to this guy, and he listens to this lady. And so he gets all of the information, and then he formulates an opinion, which in this case translates into a policy. So last night, when he's asked about whether he's going to honor the will of the people and all that, well, he may not have said it very well. He just said that, I'm just going to wait and see on this. Well, today, in his speech, after sitting on that and reflecting with other people in his campaign, obviously, he came out and he articulated his point of view on that. And he started off with a joke saying, well, I'm going to honor the will of the people if I win. So it went from there.
And that's all you heard in the press. I'll honor it if I win. They left out the rest. That's why you need to research for yourself. I'm only going to take a couple other questions, but I'm going to do one because I'm surprised it wasn't the first one. Maybe you're embarrassed to ask it, but I have the great answer for it. Is Trump a racist?
No.
The answer is no, but people will tell you, well, how do you know he's not racist? Well, you ought to be able to rattle all of this off. Before Trump got in the race, Trump was all good with everybody. Jesse Jackson, Oprah Winfrey, everybody wanted to. All the black musicians wanted to perform at his casinos. All the fighters, Don King, they had the fights in his casinos. Trump, everybody wanted to interview Trump because Trump had done what many have not done, because Trump is not old money. There's a difference in money passed down from generation to generation. Trump built his himself, and Trump was all good with everybody, black and white. But now, because he's running, the race card is one of those things that we need. And if you need something else, Trump had a black girlfriend. Google it. Yes. But let me give you one more. When they talk about Trump discriminating against blacks, there's a photograph of Trump and his father from 1972. Trump in the byline, Trump as an apprentice with his father. You know what an apprentice is? Somebody getting OJT, somebody that's not running the company. Now, it is a known fact that his father was a member of the KKK and a racist. No denying that. But the lawsuit against the businesses didn't come until 1973, which means that those policies were in place long before Trump even started running the country and the company, and Trump gets no credit for ending policies that his father put in place. And you noticed last night, if you saw it in the debate, when asked about that, Trump didn't even bother to dignify it, because Trump knows the truth of the matter. And then this is the last one. Trump, a nightclub in Tampa, I believe, served Jews and blacks.
Country club.
Yeah. They were being discriminated against by the city council. Trump filed a $100 million lawsuit against that city council on behalf of blacks and Jews. Here's a news flash. Racists don't do that. Sorry, Depreciate.
Well, it's just to go with Miss Julia's comment. I'm tired of political correctness. I'm tired of me having to tiptoe around humans. The world is not fair. Life is not easy, and we don't wear bunny slippers all day. So go with Trump, because to me, he reminds me of my mom and dad. He tell it like it is, and if you don't like it, go to your room or get out of the place. So I would rather have a real person that's not afraid of the change that we need and to get back to some kind of foundation than the liar that's next to him. And I would rather have Trump any day than Hillary Clinton stepping one more foot or toe towards 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue.
Amen.
Does anybody over here have a question? I said, yes, sir.
Following this chain of thought, if elected, how will Trump be able to heal race relations?
He wants to know, how will Trump heal race relations? Trump ain't offering nobody anything extra. Trump has said, basically, to blacks as a group, and please don't be offended. Screw you blacks, screw you Jews, screw you Mexicans, and screw you white people. And I hate even more the corrupt political elite, because they have taken all of these groups and turned them against each other with their policies. I will have no regard for your race or your ethnicity unless you make it one. And the example I close with is this. You got a guy who douses himself with gasoline, and he looks at Mr. Trump and he says, Mr. Trump, will you please light me? Mr. Trump is going to say, screw you, light yourself. I believe in every man standing up and doing what they need for themselves, because the opportunity is here for you to succeed, just like I did. And when that person turns and asks Hillary Clinton, Hillary Clinton will say, sure, light him ablaze, and then call for a tax increase so that they can hire more firemen so that maybe somebody can get there sooner and put him out the next time around. Hillary will turn it into a way to make some money. And that's it. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
There will be no healing of the race relations in this country. We have Barack Obama. He is a community organizer. Guess where he's staying once he get out of office? Washington, D.C. or Chicago. You think Al Sharpton and Jesse Jackson is a problem? You got the grand wizard right there.
Thank you, Derrick. That was great. I knew it would be. One of my all-time favorite speakers is Derrick Grayson, because he gets down to the lowest common denominator. You know, he gets us down to that point and then brings us back up. And when we get done, we're all together, because we all agreed on one thing, the truth.
Yes.
You know, that's what it's all about. Just show me the truth and I can make a good decision. That's what the American people want. They want to know the truth. That's all it's about. All right. I'm going to segue here into bringing Michael up here. And to do this, I'm going to use an example, because I have a new Facebook friend. So new. Jackson. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. We're...
Thank you.
Y'all don't mind? Pass this around and give us whatever you can. The place costs us $120 a month, so whatever you got, we'd appreciate it. Let's see. Patrick Jackson. Scott Jackson. Scott Jackson. New Facebook friend of mine. And he's introduced me into a whole new, you know, I'm 61 years old. And, you know, most of the folks in here are a little bit older too. And so we're relishing the opportunity that you're giving us with attending here, because Scott is 30 years old. And he's of a different generation, and I don't know what it's like to be 30 anymore. I don't know what it's like for the millennial generation, and so I'm getting a real clue into what the things that they're concerned about, and so I'm conversing with some of his online friends, and I'm finding out things that I had no idea were even going on, but one of his friends was talking about capitalism, and that he used the term capitalism to say, well, that's just bad news, but it's capitalism. Well, that gave me the opportunity to, and I don't want to pull rank on anybody, because a lot of what I know that I tell people, I've learned in the last 5 years. So I went all the way to 55 before I started learning some of these things. So it's not pulling rank on the next generation. But I just want to read to you, and then I'm going to show you that everything that I'm going to show you, Donald Trump knows, and he's going to deal with this when he gets to be president of the United States. I told his friend, there is no capitalist system. Any semblance of a capitalist system is an illusion protected by the corporate media. What we have is a blend of power between corporatists and government. A blend of power between corporatists and government. The corporatists own the ability to choose the politicians and punish politicians who do not help them with their goals. In the end, we will have rule by corporations. That's where we're going, folks. And I know this is news to the millennial generation, but that's exactly what's going on. And the corporations will dictate terms to the government by law. That form of government is known as corporate fascism. It's a totalitarian form of government, and that is where we're going. That is what all these trade agreements are all about, is to institute corporate control over the nations by contract. That's where this is all going. There is no free market capitalism left to any major extent in the world, and if Hillary Clinton wins, it will be gone, never to return ever. There is no government interference with the capitalist economy, only government doing the work of those who have the real power. The private parties who create the money and who are unaccountable to anyone, not even the government, for what they do with it. It is a wealth transfer protocol, folks. It is a wealth transfer protocol. The economic, an economic discipline in and of itself, run by a technocracy for the purpose of the corporatists and those who give them orders. It must be stopped, or there is no future. America will be over. That's what we're facing here. Trump understands everything that I'm telling you. This is what I'm telling your friend. I urge you to consider what Trump is telling you. All the free market economics you learned in school are a pipe dream. Don't you hate that? You go to school for 4 or 5 years, find out that everything you learn is just kind of theory and it's really not applicable, but you leave thinking that it is until you get into the real world and spend about 30 years in it and then look back and think, you know, that really wasn't the way it was. I said, all the free market economics you learned in school are a pipe dream, never to be realized if Hillary wins. That is what this election is all about. Now, I'm going to show you that Donald Trump, and this was one of the things that Derrick and I talked about early on in the Derrick metamorphosis, was to read between the lines of what Donald Trump is saying and see if what he's saying doesn't match up with reality that we know and understand. So I'm going to play you this. This was like 3 or 4 days ago, and it's about 5 minutes long, and he's going to tell you exactly what I just told you, and that he's the only one who can fix it. He is. He is a unique person in a unique place in a unique time, and he is the only one who can fix this.
Our movement is about replacing a failed and corrupt, and when I say corrupt, I'm talking about totally corrupt, political establishment with a new government controlled by you, the American people. There is nothing the political establishment will not do, no lie that they won't tell, to hold their prestige and power at your expense, and that's what's been happening. The Washington establishment and the financial and media corporations that fund it exist for only one reason: to protect and enrich itself. The establishment has trillions of dollars at stake in this election. As an example, just one single trade deal they'd like to pass involves trillions of dollars controlled by many countries, corporations, and lobbyists. For those who control the levers of power in Washington, and for the global special interest, they partner with these people that don't have your good in mind. Our campaign represents a true existential threat, like they haven't seen before. This is not simply another 4-year election. This is a crossroads in the history of our civilization that will determine whether or not we, the people, reclaim control over our government. It's a global power structure that is responsible for the economic decisions that have robbed our working class, stripped our country of its wealth, and put that money into the pockets of a handful of large corporations and political entities. They've stripped away these towns bare and raided the wealth for themselves and taken our jobs away out of our country, never to return unless I'm elected president. The Clinton machine is at the center of this power structure. We've seen this firsthand in the WikiLeaks documents in which Hillary Clinton meets in secret with international banks to plot the destruction of U.S. sovereignty in order to enrich these global financial powers her special interest friends, and her donors. The Clinton machine is so closely and irrevocably tied to the media organizations. The most powerful weapon deployed by the Clintons is the corporate media, the press. Let's be clear on one thing. The corporate media in our country is no longer involved in journalism. They're a political special interest, no different than any lobbyist or other financial entity with a total political agenda, and the agenda is not for you, it's for themselves. And their agenda is to elect crooked Hillary Clinton at any cost, at any price, no matter how many lives they destroy. For them, it's a war. And for them, nothing at all is out of bounds. This is a struggle for the survival of our nation, believe me. And this will be our last chance to save it on November 8th, remember that. This election will determine whether we're a free nation or whether we have only the illusion of democracy, but are in fact controlled by a small handful of global special interests rigging the system, and our system is rigged. This is reality. You know it, they know it, I know it, and pretty much the whole world knows it. The establishment and their media enablers wield control over this nation through means that are very well known. This is well documented, and the establishment that protects them has engaged in a massive cover-up of widespread criminal activity at the State Department and the Clinton Foundation in order to keep the Clintons in power. People who are capable of such crimes against our nation are capable of anything.
They are capable of anything.
Yep.
And the reason why was a couple of things I wanted to bring out of that in introducing Michael. Senator Williams. Is that this system that is a global system that he talks about. You notice he talked about the wealth transfer protocol that I talked about. It's a system that it's an economic system. It's not anything they taught in school, but it's an economic system that transfers the wealth from the American people to this global elite who he's talking about here. And they will do anything to stay in power. Now, this system is global, but it's also state, and it's also local. Because the corporatists have a stream of money that they can use in order to create influence over the elected officials who then feel like they have a way to stand to gain, or at least to maintain a certain base of political power. That is what this is all about. Now, the reason why I brought that in to introduce Michael is that I was pretty early. I was like October last year to jump on the Trump train. Michael, it turns out, he's been like, you know, as soon as he came out, he recognized that Trump was real, and he saw exactly what was the proper way for him to go. And so he was an early, not a convert, but he jumped on the Trump train real quickly. Just want to tell you a little bit about Michael, because what you see in Michael is kind of a reflection of what you see in Donald Trump. First of all, Michael, he's a CPA, so he knows business. He knows the business from the guts of the business. He understands how the money flows inside of a business and how things get paid for and receivables and payables and all that kind of stuff. He also understands taxes. He's got this kind of a mind. He is an entrepreneur. Michael had, what, 17, what was the name of the company?
Sport Clips Hair.
He had more franchises than anyone else in the entire country of these Sports Clips franchises. Michael did very well with that. Again, just the Trump model of persevering, doing a great job with a great idea, and then doing very well. Michael retired. He sold his businesses and retired. So then he's looking for a way to something to do with the rest of his life. He decided to give back, just like Donald Trump has decided at this point to give back. So you can kind of see, I can see kind of psychologically why Michael would be drawn to Donald Trump, because they're thinking a lot of the same thoughts. And when he did this, Michael used his own money. He put his own money into his campaign, and he put in much more than he ever gets from his salary as a Georgia State Senator. They tried to destroy him. I was amazed, because Michael is in my district over in Forsyth County. I was amazed at the mailers that they were sending out there trying to destroy Michael and his family and everything that he holds dear in this life. Just like Donald Trump said, they will stop at nothing. Well, it goes through the entire system. The entire system is that way. But Michael's persevered. He would not be deterred. Well, what do you see Donald Trump doing? Donald Trump is not going to be deterred. He's going to take this all the way through. Well, in Michael's case, he was not going to stop. He was going to push this all the way through, and it just made him that much more of a tiger. And in the end, he defeated an entrenched state senator by a vote tally of 66% to 34%. And he did it out of sheer gutting it out and knocking on 20,000 doors and doing everything that he possibly had to do in order to complete the goal that he had set out for himself. And so with that in mind, I went to a Trump event this time last year, and I'm back there in the back, and I'm going in there, and I'm just going to see what's going on. There was no security there at that time. Trump was still the clown with the red nose on, so they didn't think anything of it. Well, I get in there, and there's Michael up in the front introducing Donald Trump. I'm like, holy crap. How's this guy doing this? I mean, it's like he's just like Superman. He just sets his goal on something and he's going to accomplish it. And so, the one thing I love about Michael more than anything is that he and I may not agree on everything, but you know what? He's a stand-up guy. And he'll tell you why he believes a certain way. And he won't be shy about it. And sometimes you can even persuade him. But sometimes he can persuade you. But he's not going to back down from anything. He doesn't take it personal. He's just, the guy has the heart of what we're looking for in this country to represent us in our seats of government. If you ask me, this guy is what governor material is made out of. And with that, I want to introduce you to my friend, state senator, and co-chair of the Trump campaign in Georgia, Michael Williams.
Thank you, Hank. I don't really know if I can live up to that introduction there, but thank you. That was very kind of you. Also, I want to echo his sentiments. Thank all of you for coming out tonight. We really are in a very, very important time in our country. The fate of our country is in our hands, in your guys' hands. The fact that you guys came out tonight means a lot to me and a lot about where you guys stand. And also, what Hank did actually led up to exactly what I'm going to talk about. And I didn't tell Hank really what I was going to talk about, so it's kind of amazing. And one of them is, I'm going to tell you three different stories tonight. And at the end of the three stories, I'll kind of combine it, bring it all together. But the first one is why I got behind Donald Trump so early. And he's right, there's summer of last year, I came out and was the first elected official to support Donald Trump. And a lot of it is exactly what he talked about. I looked at Donald Trump, I looked at his background, and it resembled my background, but on a much smaller scale, and I'm not worth billions of dollars. And I also looked at our country, and I looked at the 17 or so candidates that were running for the Republican nominee, and I saw a lot of good guys. I saw a lot of good guys that had a good heart, that wanted to do what they felt like was best for our country, and I felt like if they were elected, it would slow the process down a little bit. But none of them would be able to do what it would take to actually change the direction of our country. Only Donald Trump, in my mind, would be able to do that, would be able to withstand the attacks. And I want to go into a little more detail about some of the attacks that they did, because again, I was busy, before I got involved in politics, I was busy raising my family, running my own business, and I'd never really attended a Tea Party event, had never been to a GOP event, just spent time with my family and with my job. So whenever I first decided to run, I started showing up some of these places and people had no clue who I was. I sat down with my consultant, like, okay, we need to make a list of everybody you know in the county. So we can kind of get them start talking to everybody, get them start talking to their friends. So they said, okay, who do you know? So I know about three people in the county. They're like, what do you mean you know three people in the county? That's all I know. I know I got my neighbors, I got my kids' teachers, you know, that's about all I know. So, well, how do you think you're gonna win this thing? I said, well, we're committed, we're gonna go out there, we're gonna work hard, and we believe that we can do it. One of the first things that I did was I called up Jack Murphy, the incumbent, and just let him know, hey, I'm Michael Williams, I'm gonna run for state senate, I'm gonna run for office you hold. Do you want to meet? He said, sure. So he brought me over to his house. He sits me down and he starts to rattle off all these people that he knows, how close he is with the lieutenant governor, how he's got the backing of every single person down in the Capitol. He's been in, down there for 12 years or so, and you know, he's really, really entrenched. And if Michael, if you just hold off a little bit, if you just hold off, you know, get involved more in the community, we'll put you on a board here, we can get you there, basically earn your stripes, let us know we can trust, let you know that you're gonna do the things you're supposed to do, then maybe in the coming years, you know, you can run for office. Basically telling me, if we can indoctrinate you first of all and put you in place, then maybe you can run. I said, well, Jack, I appreciate that, but I feel very convicted that I need to run for this office. Whether win or lose, I'm gonna run, and I appreciate that. I said, well, you know what? At the snap of a finger, I can call Casey Cagle up and get $250,000 to run for my campaign. I said, dang it, Jack, I was hoping you wouldn't say that, because I got this consultant who said it's going to cost me about $300,000 to run this campaign. I was just hoping he was just saying that. So if that's what it's going to take, that's what it's going to take. And I ended up actually spending about $330,000 of my own dollars in this campaign. The next thing I had was with Mark Hamilton. He was kind of Jack's counterpart there in Forsyth County. He brings me into his office, we're sitting there, we're talking, a lot of the same stuff. You know, why don't you just get more involved in the community? You know, why do you want to do this? Blah, blah, blah. In the middle of it, I think it was orchestrated. I don't have anything to prove this, but I think it was orchestrated. He gets his phone rings. He looks down and he says, hold on a minute, it's the Speaker of the House. He asked me to leave his office, so I leave his office about 5 minutes, and then comes back in and says, I thought that was the Speaker, ready to talk about a couple of things, whatever. So I think that was his way to try to intimidate, but again, I'm not really involved in politics. I don't know who the Speaker of the House is, so it didn't really matter to me who was calling. So we ran the race, and we announced. About a month after we announced, I get this unmarked vanilla envelope full of all kinds of horrific things. They had gotten in touch with my ex-wife. And she basically accused me of everything under the sun, with the exception of being a pedophile. There are accusations about me having gambling problems, problems with prostitutes, strippers, you name it. I had done it. I beat my wife. I neglected my kids. It was all kinds of horrific stuff. And then there was this typed out note that said, if you do not withdraw from the race, this will be made public. Well, I held on to that. I didn't let anybody know about it whenever it first came out. Jack, the brilliant guy that he is, once session starts in January, he starts going around. Because what they do down there is they talk about the guys that are running against you. And they all talk about how crazy they are, how nut jobs they are, whatever it is. And he had these papers. And he was going around showing everybody, you know, look, this guy's crazy, this guy's nuts, this guy's a wife beater, this guy's, you know, whoever it might be. Well, about a month in the session, we make this announcement that we had received this envelope had all this horrible stuff in it. Well, Jack can't deny it anymore because he's been going around telling everybody about it. So he's kind of caught red-handed that he was the one that did it. But they sent out mailers. They created this website called Michael Williams Gone Wild. And they sent out mailers, everybody directing them to this website. And it was so bad that they took my mom's name, birth date, address, and social security number and put it on the internet. That's how bad it was. Like Hank talked about, we didn't let that deter us. I had all kinds of people call saying, Mike, you gotta do this, Mike, you need to do this. And I was just kind of retaliating to some of the stuff. And I was like, no, we have our message, we have what we wanna do, and we're not going to be distracted from that. We're just going to focus on what we feel like is important, and that is fairly being represented. Because when you really think about that, that's what we all want, and none of us feel like we have, is fair representation, either at the state level or at the national level. And we went, we knocked on $20,000, spent $330,000. We spent, my kids, they're in spring break, while all their other friends are at the beach enjoying themselves. We're out there knocking on doors and working our tails off. And sure enough, we won. We won 66-34. And I would love to say that it was all because of me, because I'm just such a great, amazing guy. But I know that's not true. I know we worked our tails off. I know that I was given resources that I was able to put into the campaign. But I also know we prayed every single night. That we turned our hearts to our Father in heaven, and I felt like He wanted me to run. And those that might have heard last time I spoke, I talked about that a little bit, and I felt convicted that I needed to run. And everybody I talked to is, I need to run, I'm gonna do everything I can because I feel like I need to run. Never did I say I need to win. I just needed to run. If I did everything that I could do, put it in God's hands, He would take care of the rest, and He did, and we won. That's kind of the first story. The second story is I was boarding an airplane here in Atlanta going to Richmond, Virginia for a conference this past summer. And one of the things I like to do to combat some of what the media says out there is I love wearing Donald Trump paraphernalia. I have a Donald Trump shirt, I've got a Make America Great hat, and I put on my Make America Great hat, went down to Hartsfield International Airport, and wore that hat all over the place. And I got some high fives, some handshakes, and I got some kind of scary looks as well. So, you know, how dare you wear that hat at this airport or whatnot. And I was going through security. You know, the guy that's standing right there, you have to give your boarding pass and your license. They let you go through to get screened and all that. He was a black guy. I give him my stuff, got on my Make America Great hat. And he lets me go by, and as I'm walking by, he said, excuse me, sir. And I turn around, I'm kind of preparing myself for what's he gonna say, how am I gonna respond to this? I turn around and I say, yes, sir. He's like, we really need to get that guy elected. I was like, yes, I love it. So I went through security, went, boarded the plane. As I was boarding the plane, I got one of those kind of stink eye looks from one of the stewards. And I just kind of smiled at her, went down and sat in my seat. About the time the plane is supposed to take off, we hear an announcement over the intercom saying that the flight has been delayed. They're waiting on the co-pilot. It's going to take a little bit longer, but we've got to figure out where he is, how long it's going to take, so just kind of bear with us. We hear that story a few more times. The flight is delayed by about 20 minutes. Again, I'm just kind of sitting there in my chair, annoyed that the flight's delayed, but not really doing anything. When we land, I was traveling with David Schaefer, the Senate President Pro Tem. He was sitting in first class and kind of witnessed what was going on that really caused the delay. The stewardess, I only assume it was the stewardess that gave me that stink eye, made a stink about my hat, and she called it a microaggressive act. All right, again, remember, my hat said, Make America Great Again. And the bag, it had Trump. That was it. But she felt like that was a microaggressive act. So they were talking. This entire time, the stewards were talking, okay, what are we going to do? How are we going to handle this? Should we kick him off the plane? Should we make him take his hat off? How are we going to handle this? And they take a vote.
There's three of them, and it was 2-1, not to do anything. The stewardess wasn't very happy about that, so she went to the pilot. Had the same discussion with the pilot. Now, this is a microaggressive act, he's offending me, we've got to do something about it. Thank goodness the pilot made the right decision and didn't do anything as well. But nonetheless, we were delayed 20 minutes because of this. The reason I share that story is, again, the media. Why did that stewardess feel like my hat was a microaggressive act? Why did she take offense to that hat? If you take it for what it's written, very literally, it's we're going to just make America green. But the media has ingrained upon people that that represents Donald Trump, who is a racist, a sexist, a xenophobe, all these horrible and horrific things. Well, why is the media driving this narrative home so hard? In my mind, it's because Hillary Clinton is by far the worst candidate the Democrats have had in my lifetime, if not ever. They know that they have a very limited number of people who are going to come out and vote for Hillary Clinton. The only way for her to win is to suppress the vote, to make people question, why would I, well, not even want to be associated with Donald Trump. I don't want to be classified with him. I can't tell you how many people, I've been traveling the state, stumping for Trump, talking to people about Donald Trump, and how many people, when you first talk to them about the presidential race, they're kind of hesitant, you know, I don't like either candidate, blah, blah, blah. When they find out that I'm the state co-chair of the Donald Trump campaign, the first elected official in Georgia to endorse Donald Trump, their tune changes. Oh, I really do like Donald Trump. You know, I think he can do some good things. I think he can do some great things. And but they had to get permission from me, first of all, before they felt comfortable enough to say that. Again, that's just because of what the media is doing. I was playing basketball with a guy the other day who I go to church with, and he just hates Donald Trump. And I'm like, well, why? Why do you hate him so bad? Just his policies, blah, blah, blah. So I start rattling off, you know, his tax policy. As we're playing basketball, we're playing down low, we're kind of bumping each other and following each other and all that. We're talking politics at the same time, talking about the difference between Donald Trump's tax policy and Hillary Clinton's tax policy, abortion, all these different things. And about an hour into the game, he just kind of reluctantly leans over and says, all right, I'm probably going to vote for Donald Trump, but don't tell anybody. Again, just they're out there pushing this narrative because they know that Hillary Clinton has a cap, and they have to prevent people, not legally, but, you know, by stereotyping, by making it so you don't want to associate with it. You don't want to stand up for them either. We gave a neighbor a Donald Trump sign. Actually, it was kind of a joke. I made a bet with them. They lost the bet. And I said, I'm going to put a Donald Trump sign in your yard because you lost the bet. And middle night, I go out there, I put it in their yard, and they wake up the next morning, and they see a couple people drive by. And in their minds, the people that drove by gave them the stink eye. And they thought it was because it was a Donald Trump sign. Again, just the ingrainedness of what the media has done. So that's part of one of the reasons why I wanted to support Trump was some of these other guys that were running, there's no way that they could stand up to the pressures that the media is going to put against them. Only somebody that is as arrogant, as egotistical as Donald Trump could actually go through and do this. The last story that I want to kind of tell you is more of a personal story to me that I might go teary-eyed, so please apologize or send my apology beforehand. But on July 23rd of last year, my son was involved in an accident. It was a longboarding accident. I've got three kids, two sons and a little girl, and they were out playing with their longboard. He wasn't wearing a helmet. He fell, he hit his head, and he had to go to the hospital. I wasn't with him at the time. I got a call from his other brother, Jared. He said, Dad, Emma had an accident here. Talk to the police officer. He'll tell you what happened. The police officer said, you know, his son, he hit his head. Ambulance came, took him to the hospital just as a precautionary issue, and he should be okay. So as I was driving to the hospital, I was more mad at my son than anything else because this isn't really new to him. He's very accident prone. He takes some risks that he probably shouldn't take. And I was thinking, okay, I'm going to take his car away and do all these different things to punish him. But when I get to the hospital, I realized pretty quickly, this isn't our typical emergency room visit. He was in a room all by himself. It wasn't in one of the rooms where there's lots of other people or just partitioned by a little screen or whatnot. He had his own little room. He was sitting in the middle of it, and the cords were coming down from the ceiling. He was hooked up to all these machines over to the right.
and he was no longer responsive. When the police officer told me, first of all, he was responsive, he was no longer responsive at this point. We were in there for about 10 minutes, and the nurse came in and rushed us out. And they said, we have to intubate your son. And I remember walking out of his little room there thinking, okay, this is not good. This is going to be a very, very rough night for us. This was about 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. They intubated him, put him in a room, put him in an IC room. We're in there, we're with him again. He's still out. He's not responsive. Nurses are coming in, checking on him at about midnight. The nurses run in, mess with him, and then rush him out and say, we have to do emergency surgery. His brain has expanded so much that it's putting pressure on his spinal cord, and if we don't basically remove his skull, he's going to die. So obviously that was some horrific news that we had to hear. It was supposed to, the surgery was supposed to last about an hour and a half. It was about 2.5 hours later. He finally comes back. He's alive, but the doctor brings us to the back and pretty much tells us, you know, your son's alive, but we've done everything that we can do for him. Whether or not he continues to live or not will be up to him. But if he does live, he's not going to be the same son that you remember. His brain has expanded so much, and on top of that, he had a stroke where he lost about 15% of his right frontal lobe. So again, if he makes it, we just want you to be prepared that there's going to be some challenges. He's going to have to learn to walk, learn to talk. He's going to have to learn to read and write. He's going to have to learn all these things all over again. And it's going to be a very, very challenging life for him. Well, the next 4 or 5 days, probably the worst days of my life. We had to watch my son go through what's called neuro shock, where his body basically just it shuts down, and every ounce of energy that he has is going to heal his brain. His body can no longer control his temperature, regulate his temperature, so his temperature will spike up to 104, 105, 106 degrees. They'll put ice on and all that, and then it'll drop to 92, 93, 94 degrees. And it was always worse at night. I remember I went there just kind of sitting with my wife thinking, oh my goodness, watching the sunset. Here we go again. After about 4 or 5 days, though, they were able to wake him up. He was in an induced coma. They were able to wake him up, and a week after that, we were able to transfer him out of ICU into the Shepherd Center. And for anybody who doesn't know, the Shepherd Center is a world-class, really, which is one of the best organizations and hospitals in the world when it comes to brain and spinal injuries. So we're able to get him into Shepherd's, and they bring him in, and they tell us the same things. Like, you know, I know you love your son, I know you're going to be there for him, but we just want to prepare you that this is going to be a very, very long process. It could take up to 2 years for us to really know the full impact of what's going to happen. They sat us down and brought in nurses and other people to kind of get the lay of our home, how we're going to have to handicap it and do all these things. During all this, our story had gotten out there. A lot of you, I've kind of seen say shaking their heads and yeah, I remember the story. We had people around the state, around the country. In fact, we've counted 7 different countries around the world where people were praying for my son. And what happened is nothing short of a miracle. And that is two weeks after we were accepted in the Shepherds, my son walked out of the hospital able to read and write and remember. This happened in July. He missed the first half of school. He was a senior. He missed the first half of school. He was able to go back to school in January and graduate with his class. It is nothing short of a miracle. I told you earlier that I won the election, but not because of me, because of my Father in Heaven. And when I won, I didn't really know why the heck I won. I mean, I I don't know what I'm doing down there. I try to figure it out. I'm a pretty quick learning, quick study. So I think I've kind of picked up a lot of what's going on. But what I've done is everywhere I go to speak, I share that story. Because no matter what happens to me going forward, if I can share the story that God lives, that God loves us, and He still performs a miracle, I feel like I've done my job. Now, the reason I share that with you is because I truly believe in miracles. And I believe that Donald Trump is a miracle that the American public needs.
Amen.
He might not be the miracle that we want, you know. He might not be, you know, if we could say this is the guy that we want to represent us, he's probably not that guy. But again, he has gone through some stuff. He has the personality and the attributes that we need right now as Americans. Like him, love him, hate him, he's the guy that's going to help change our country. Now, he is up against, I mean, we heard it from his own mouth, he is up against a machine that is going to do everything that they can to destroy him. And that's where the miracle part comes in for me. Not necessarily that's Donald Trump, but that to overcome that machine, to overcome everything that they're going to do to try to give the election to Hillary, it's going to take God's effort. And we as citizens, we as Americans, we as Christians, we need to do everything we can to lift Him up in our prayers. We need to do everything that we can to ask God to help us elect the right person. Because I don't think we can do it ourselves. I think we're to the point now where it's going to take God's hand coming down and helping us to win this election. So that's what I ask everybody to do. There's two things I ask people to do. One, pray to lift up Donald Trump in your prayers. And then do not be ashamed or scared or intimidated in showing your support for Donald Trump. Because if you do, you're allowing the media to win. You're allowing them to win. And we cannot do that. We have to take it upon ourselves to lead the charge, to lead this movement, to lead this revolution. And it starts with every one of us. Good question.
Well, I took your lead and I actually did it. I put a Trump bumper sticker on the back of my car. So you can imagine going down 316, 85 to 285 every morning and having people do this. And almost swerve over because they actually cannot believe that I have that on the back of my car. But now I'm getting waves and humps, and I'm like, am I the only one riding around with this on the car? I guess I am.
Yeah, no, I mean, just to see a black individual with a Trump bumper sticker, want to see a Trump bumper sticker, then to go up the Trump in front of the car and see, wow, it's a black person, completely defies what's being pushed down everybody's by right now by the media. So congratulations and keep it up. So that's kind of the story about how I got behind Donald Trump. That's why I think Donald Trump is the guy. Again, he's not perfect, not by any stretch of the imagination. He has said some things that I find offensive. The comments that he made with the Bush character, horrific. I mean, if I was president and I heard him talk about that, I would be completely offended by it. But doesn't mean that he's not fit to be president. It doesn't mean that he can't make the right decisions, right choices. And he's doing it by calling out all the corruption. Can you see Ted Cruz? Can you see Jeb Bush doing any of this? Not at all. Not at all. He's the guy that's leading the charge, and he's the guy that we need to support.
Talking about miracles, I see the fact that Trump is where he is as a miracle. We had 17 candidates, and the clown, as they called him, rose to the top doing everything that was politically wrong. If that's not a miracle, what is?
No, exactly, exactly. And also, whenever we hear these polls, anybody here believe the polls?
No.
Good.
Ask if anybody ever hears something been polled.
Has anybody ever been polled?
Yeah, I actually was polled. Yeah. I was polled.
Okay, so we got two.
Does anybody, everybody else, do you know anybody that's ever been polled besides this lady here?
Who was Bart there?
Me.
Yeah, Jim in the back.
Thank you.
Derrick, during the primary, we all heard the pollsters out there talking. You know, he comes up pretty strong. I think it was 17-18%. They said he might cap out at 22%, and as all the other candidates start to fall off, they're not going to Trump. Trump's maxed out. Trump's got everybody that he's going to get.
as these candidates start to fall off, they're going to go to everybody other than Trump. And who kept getting a disproportional part of the votes? Donald Trump. Every single time, more people went to him than any other candidate. And you're absolutely right. That just the fact that he is where he is a modern-day miracle. And I don't trust the polls out there today. Again, I was at an Atlanta Young Republicans gathering. It was February of last year. So there were still quite a few candidates in the running for the GOP. And I was down there, and I said, I know you guys kind of laugh at me and whatnot because I support Donald Trump, but I'm going to tell you something else that you're really going to laugh at. I mean, this was February before he'd won the nominations. Not only is he going to win the nomination, he's going to be the GOP nominee, but he is going to win the general election by a landslide. It is going to be huge. And I believe whatever we see on November 9th, is only going to be a fraction of what it really is, because he is going to win this thing huge. I can't tell you how many people, again, as they're going around there, not just Georgia. You're a Georgia state senator. Obviously, Georgia's going to go red. But as I've traveled all over the state, as I talk to people all over the state, I was talking to a guy in California the other day, and he was driving down the road. He said whenever he got there, he was expecting to see Hillary stuff everywhere. So he saw like two bumper stickers and maybe a one-yard sign. Nobody is excited about Hillary Clinton. Even her own party isn't excited about Hillary Clinton. But yet, look at early voting. Yeah, how many people show up for our rallies? 200-300, you know, and we've got 10,000 and 12,000 people showing up for Donald Trump rallies. But here in Georgia, early voting, we've had over 100,000 people early vote. That was just the first day. I haven't seen after 4 days, but in Forsyth County, 8% of registered voters have already early voted. I'm telling you, it's not for Hillary Clinton. People, and nationwide, again, on the first day of early voting, over 1.1 million people early voted. Every single state doesn't have early voting 3 weeks out. People are excited about what Donald Trump represents and the change that he can bring to our political system. And with that, I'll take any questions.
I have one comment. I think WikiLeaks has been our NSA to get the facts out. Mm-hmm. Stuff's coming out every day.
Exactly.
They cut him off in Paris. But you know, he's got alternate systems. You know, it's like blood flow. They got to come through another one.
Yeah. And did you guys see how Hillary Clinton pivoted on that question at the debate? Now, she never wants to deny that she said it, because she can't deny, since it's evidence that she said it. So she, instead of admitting it and saying, yes, I do believe in open borders, even though I've said earlier tonight that I don't, it's Russia's fault. You know, it's Russia's fault that I can't, you know, play you guys, and because Russia's doing it, and oh yeah, by the way, Donald Trump is associated with Russia. So again, it's just a humongous curve they're trying to throw to convince the American people that WikiLeaks is a traitor. Don't believe it. Only believe Hillary Clinton, because she is going to tell you what you want to hear.
Questions?
Any other questions?
What committees are you on?
I am on the Ethics Committee. I'm the Vice Chair of Ethics. I serve on the Finance Committee, Higher Education Committee, Public Safety, and State and Local Governments. But that will change in January. We have a new biennial. We have a few more senators coming in and changing in committee assignments. So hopefully I'll get a couple different ones.
I have a question.
Sure.
Somebody had asked, I don't know if they still want an answer, but I do. Can you explain your support for Amendment 1?
Sure. Yeah, sure. I think that's the question you're going to ask as well, what I think about Amendment 1. I voted yes on the bill for Amendment 1. A lot of that was for straight up political reasons. There were other bills I had going through that one of them was before this bill that I was working on passed, it was an ethics violation for a member of the school board to vocally oppose an issue once it was voted on. That was the state school board's position, that once a measure is voted, you have to fall in line, you cannot speak out against it. I think that's wrong, completely wrong. So I presented a bill that said that the state board cannot have anything that prevents a board member from exercising their First Amendment right to speak up no matter what happens. I knew that if I voted against Amendment 1, the Constitution Amendment, that bill would die. So in my mind, it was more important to get that out there so we could have board members across the state. We talk about local control. We can't have local control if our board members can't speak up. We need our board members at the local level to have their voice and let people know what's going on.
Butch Miller was talking about that, wasn't it? Wasn't Butch Miller the one toting that particular bill?
The bill that I'm talking about right now?
Yeah.
No, that was the bill I sponsored.
No, I meant the other.
Oh, Amendment 1?
You voted on this one.
Yeah, Butch was the lead sponsor of Amendment 1.
So just to make sure I understand you, you voted for this so that another bill you were putting forth would not die.
That's part of it. The other one is, yes, that's partly correct. Mm-hmm. The other reason is, whenever it comes to constitutional amendments, and you know, I represent the people that elected me, but I also like for them to have their voice as well. And a constitutional amendment is able to go to the people so that they can vote on it as well. So for those two reasons, I voted for it. But I've also said that, in fact, I was on a radio station in Athens just last week where I said I would be voting no on the ballot question.
Well, just my opinion.
Sure.
Based on what was presented today, basically the people who have this, most of those failing schools are in poor black areas where they won't even go and participate. And according to this legislation, once the governor's choice makes up his mind, there is no appeal. So I don't see the upside of voting yes for this to give the people the voice when they won't have one anyway if this passes. And
what if that doesn't pass? There's a lot of opposition out there.
Well, what was made?
There's a ton. Do you know that there's only been one school system in the entire state that's come out in support of this? Other school system has come out against this amendment.
I've not seen any opposition to it.
I have.
I've missed that, and I hope that.
And again, I don't know if it's going to pass or not. I don't have any inside polling or anything like that. But also another thing that I do like about what's going on right now is we're actually talking about education and solutions. And we do have a poor education system in Georgia that needs help. And this is bringing this to the forefront where we can talk about and hopefully come up with some solutions that will work. If this does pass.
If you're interested, the current polling is 44% against, but unless that hits 50, it won't matter. So.
What is for it?
34. It's about 44, 34, and then 20.
So 44 is against?
44 is against.
Yeah. And 34 is for it?
Yes. And 20% is undecided. That's the only current polling that we have on.
Well, everybody get on social media and every platform that you possibly have and let your opinion be known. Got one more question.
Kind of going off of education.
Sure.
It's about young people, right? Well, why is there such lack of young people entering in both the Democrat and Republican parties right now? Y'all are getting older and older. Mm-hmm.
Check down. Well, are you a part of a party right now? Are you in
a part of a yes.
The Republican Party? And the Democrat Party?
I am a member of the alt-right.
The what?
The alternative right.
The alternative right. Okay.
I was formerly a member of the Republican Party. But
you left it?
Well, with what they've done to Trump, I can't in good conscience.
Yeah. Let's, first of all, I can only speculate as to why some of the younger people are not being part of the party, or either party, so I don't have any factual or anything I can kind of point to other than just my own intuition. But I would have to speculate that they just don't feel like either party represents them. When you look at what is portrayed out there by the media, you have the Democrats who are very socially liberal. And that's what their push is. When you look at what's being pushed down by the media, what Republicans are, they're these right-winged Christians that want to Bible beat everybody with a head. So as a young person, which one of those appeals to you?
Neither.
And so I think that's why that both parties, particularly the Republican Party, needs to do a better job of messaging about what we are really about. And that's also one of the reasons why I like Donald Trump so much. I've had people ask me, well, Michael, isn't the fact that all these Republicans are turning on Donald Trump, don't you see that as a bad thing? I say absolutely not. I think that is a very good thing because he's weeding out those who really don't believe in Republican principles. And when he wins and when he gets down to D.C., do you think it's going to get any easier? No, it's not getting any easier. He needs to know who's going to be there, who's going to have his back, who's going to be with him through thick and thin, and that's what he's figuring out right now, is who's going to stay with him. So I hope that kind of answers your question. And then lastly, before I turn it over, I do want to kind of stand up for the governor. I've got to know the governor, and while you might not necessarily approve of the OSD and then the school district, I do believe that both the governor and Sandra Deal are doing this from a good place to work. What I have seen down there is all kinds of information is thrown at you, all kinds, some good, some bad, and it's really hard sometimes to sift through what is right and what is wrong. But I really do believe that the governor and the first lady are trying to do this from a good place in their heart.
So the attempt to legalize no-knock search warrants, which is codified already as being illegal, is from a good place in his heart.
Is what does no-knock search warrants have to do with the OSD?
That's another story, and I know Hank is ready to close out.
So, on Opportunity School District, I've been really disappointed with the governor, but then I'm hearing from people down at the Capitol that he's really been misled by very young staffers. Is that what you're, what's going on? Why would he be so fooled? You've been truthful the whole night, so just say the truth. No one here will tell.
Yeah. I'm going to answer that by saying I'm going to pull a political stunt here. I can't answer that directly.
Your face
answer. I can't answer that directly. But what I can say is that this past session there was a lot of bills that were passed that helped teachers as far as testing. We reduced the number of testing. There's going to be some more bills coming out from the governor that will not just affect the Opportunity School District, but all the schools to help with the funding, to help again with more testing, to help everybody else in education. So again, I believe he really wants to do a good job. And he also vetoed the gun bill in religious liberty. So yeah, he's not perfect.
Well, thank Michael. Everybody give him a hand.
Yeah, we are all running a little bit long, but I think it's been a really good meeting, and I appreciate everybody hanging in there because we had, I think it was a really good session we had here. But I want to close with this, and we've touched on this theme throughout the evening, and that is that we can't do this by ourselves. We don't have the power to do this by ourselves, but we know who does, and it's written in the scriptures. He's given us the recipe, that word's been used tonight, given us the recipe in order to bring change back to our country, to restore it back to a godly path. And it's written in the 2 Chronicles 7:14. And so I'm going to read this. Everybody just concentrate on this while I read it, because this is really important. While I'm doing this, just kind of project this all across our land, okay? This is God talking. It says, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear them from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. He's told us what to do. So this is what we need to do. Project that. Project it all over our country. And then let's just enjoy November 4th. And November 8th. And after it's all done, and Donald Trump is going to be our next president, let's get him, get behind him 100%. Michael.
Well, to throw out one thing before we dismiss. If you live in Hall County, the county commission is looking right now at adding some stuff to our zoning requirements so that if you need to replace your screen door on your house or on your barn or whatever it might be, you will have to go get a building permit to repair it.
What?
You heard me.
That ain't
happening. It is. If we don't stop it, it's happening. It's in the planning right now.
I got it right here.
Johnny, I hope you have to hire a licensed contractor to do that too. Okay, folks, I want to dismiss this. Appreciate everybody hanging in there, and we had a great meeting. Thank you very much. We'll see you. Look, we do this every Thursday. Every third Thursday of the month. Not every Thursday. Every third Thursday of the month. And you see what kind of great information you're going to get here if you come back and see us every month. So, appreciate it very much.
Because you know the Democrats are capable of really. I mean, I know they're mad, but I didn't think they'd gotten that mad yet where they're going to kill people.